Now, very good morning to all. And Ignited Mind is the most powerful weapon on the earth, above the earth, and under the earth. And this is got through education. Good morning, everybody. Really, it's a very delight to have you all here. I'm joined by Professor Gautam R. Desraju, the speaker of the today's distinguished lecture from IIC Bengaluru, Dr. Rajendra Joshi, also the moderator of the session, and founder and CEO of RI Instruments and Innovation India, Professor Shailja Pant, Principal Dolphin Institute, Dr. Arun Kumar, Director of the Institute, and the various attendees from length and breadth of this country, as well as from the overseas. I, Dr. Ashish Rathudi, welcome you all on behalf of Dolphin Institute and RI Instruments and Innovation India. Before going ahead, I would like to remind you that Dolphin Institute constantly looking for the people who push the boundaries, for the people who questioned the status quo in every trajectory of life. As far as science and science education are concerned in this country, Professor Desraju belongs to that category of intellectuals who has a gumption to appeal the science imagination beyond the space and time. He is an epitome of crystal engineering in the field of science, and I'm assured his crystal clear vision of science education, which will be very insightful to make us shift from our comfort position to new thought-provoking solution in this, during this and post-pandemic landscape. So without any further ado, I would like to request Dr. Anu Kumar, the director of the institute, please, sir, for your address. Now, sir, it's over to you. Please, sir.
Thank you, Ashish. Am I audible?
Yes.
Thank you, sir. A very good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and a very warm welcome to all the participants on behalf of Dolphin Postgraduate Institute of Biomedical and Natural Sciences, Dehradun, India. It's my privilege to extend a very warm welcome to our distinguished speaker of the day, Professor Gautam R. Desiraju from Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. Subhatyam, sir, I feel great pleasure in welcoming our partner in this event, Dr. Rajendra Prasad Joshi. Namaskar, sir. Founder and CEO of RI Instruments and Innovation India. Friends, the COVID-19 pandemic has brought an unprecedented crisis to the educational landscape in the world. Many universities across the globe have decided to shut their traditional classrooms where learning was done face to face till 2021 or until the situation normalizes. In these tough times, world needs to make decisions rapidly and change equally fast to ensure that the digital divide between students are minimized and the goals on imparting quality education are not compromised. There are, however, challenges to overcome. Some students without reliable internet access and/or technology struggle to participate in digital learning. This gap is seen across countries and between the income brackets within the countries. For example, while 95% of the students in Switzerland, Norway, and Austria have a computer to use for their schoolwork, only 34% in Indonesia do. In India too, situation is not too bright. According to 2017-18 National Sample Survey Report on Education, only 24% of Indian households have internet facility, though it is 42% for urban households, but only 15% in rural households. For those who do have access to the right technology, there is evidence that learning online can be more effective in a number of ways. Recent research suggests that online learning has been shown to increase retention of information and take less time, meaning the changes coronavirus have caused might be here to stay. However, just moving classrooms online would not mean effective remote learning. One-to-one interactions among peers and teachers are very important for learning. Considering this fact, our institute has jointly organized this webinar with RI Instruments and Innovations India. The distinguished speaker of the day, eminent scientist Professor Gautam R. Desiraju, Professor Solid State and Structural Chemistry Unit, Indian Institute of Sciences, Bangalore, is going to deliver his address on long-term vision for science education during and post-pandemic landscape. Friends, it's a happy omen that more than 300 participants from 18 states across India and overseas countries have chosen to attend the webinar. In my opinion, it's a positive move forward in our willingness to accept the changing paradigm in post-COVID-19 education process. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for being part of us with this seminar. I'm sure you would all enjoy listening to Professor Desiraju. Have a good day. Jai Hind. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your kind words. And now I would like to request Dr. R.P. Joshi, founder and CEO of RI Instruments and Innovation. He is the man who belongs to the instrument industry and playing a key role for providing the bridge between the Dolphin Institute and to Dr. Professor Gautam R. Desiraju. For moderating the today's session, I would like to request him, please, sir, introduce our speaker to the audience. Please, sir, it's over to you.
Good morning, all. I hope all of you are safe and healthy in these bad days of COVID-19. First of all, I would like to thank the Dolphin Institute, especially Dr. Arun, Principal Gupta, especially Dr. Ashish, for having this kind of vision to invite a listen to speak. You know, it's very interesting for me today. I would feel like a privilege for me to moderate a session where the speaker is going to be Professor Gautam R. Desiraju. In fact, I've been asked to introduce a listen who actually doesn't need any kind of introduction. A majority of academicians, researchers, scientists, industrialists across the globe know about him. My introducing Professor Gautam R. Desiraju is something like I am going to read one page out of a library. But I have to be formal, I have to read that. There could be few, they might not be knowing about him. That's also true. What they can do? You can simply write in Google, Professor Gautam R. Desiraju. You don't write, you can take a voice help of Google. It's more than enough. So I will just read few things about Professor Gautam R. Desiraju. He's actually, at present, he's at the Institute of Science, Bangalore. Prior to this, he has been at University of Hyderabad for a long period, around 3 decades. He played a major role in the development of growth of synthetic crystal engineering and weak hydrogen bonding. However, you know, he is well known throughout the globe for his discoveries. I will use the word, he's a discoverer actually, for weak hydrogen bonding. However, it's very interesting actually. He worked for weak hydrogen bonding, but he, as a human, his bonding has been very, very strong. Very nicely, he connected science with society. How? You know, he is known as the father of crystal engineering. When we say crystals, simply we say the biggest example is pharma. Tablets we eat. He has used his role to connect the society and science in this way. There are several untold stories about him, which you can Google and search. Few of them are quite interesting. Really interesting. I've been a follower of him since long. I will just read about few of his more credentials actually. I'm a small person to read it, but I have to be formal. He is one of the highly cited scientists, discoverers, researchers across the globe. More than approximately 50,000 scientists he has had. He has got several awards, like Alexander Baum, a Mold Fellowship, for about Tuas Academy in Science. He has guided dozens of PhD scholars, those who are working in several domains in the science and different places across the globe. He has been former president of International Union of Cryptography. I would like to tell you, when he was the president, he has done this event in Hyderabad few years ago. It was quite successful event, one of the first events of India. And beyond that, he has got honorary doctorate from several universities in India and abroad. And he is also the recipient of PCRA Medal from the Kolkata. He has also received ISA Medal from the University of Bologna. And at present, he is actually in the chairman of the Research Council of several Council of India. I will not tell the names, you can find it out. This, you know, what I'm reading is here is actually nothing, you know. As I told you, I'm just reading one page out of a library. What you can do is Google him, search about him, and know about him. You know, his credentials, his beauty. And there are a few very good stories, you know, untold stories actually, very interesting. So, with my great heart, I would like to welcome Professor Gautam Maharshiraju, enlighten the society, sir. Over to Ashish, please welcome Professor Gautam Maharshiraju.
Welcome, sir. Please, sir. It's over to you, Professor Gautam Maharshiraju. Please, sir. It's over to you.
Yes. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Can everybody hear me?
Yes, sir. Sure.
Yes, sir. Please carry on.
I still see myself on the small picture, but I guess that's okay.
Sir, you are on live.
Fine. Well, I would like to start off by thanking the Dolphin Institute, Dehradun, Dr. Atish, and Dr. Rajendra Joshi, who, as was correctly pointed out, liaised between me and the Dolphin Institute to make this morning's talk possible. I too, like many others, am getting used to speaking in front of a computer screen. I guess this is something that COVID has done to all of us. I'm not sure whether I like this format compared to being in a real lecture room and talking to people whom I can see all the time. So it's different. So we have to learn how to do things a bit differently after COVID. I think that's the first thing. And I've been asked to speak on long-term vision for science education during and post the pandemic landscape. This during the landscape I will take at the very end of my talk. And I first want to talk about post landscape because it is long-term vision. So long-term vision is not possible during the landscape. We hope that the pandemic is not a long-term thing. So I think long-term vision is for the future. So I have 5 or 6 points and I'd like to stay within the 1 hour. And I'd like to start talking about how a country becomes powerful. Well, this may seem an odd place to begin for a lecture on science education, but it's not really so odd. You know, the power of a country, its geopolitical importance, how much it influences other countries, how effective it is to prevent other countries from troubling it. All these things are extremely important in today's world. They have been important from the beginning of history, actually. And it's not that a country wants to harass its neighbors. Certainly, I don't believe India wants to harass any of its neighbors. It is not in our history. It is not in our dharma to do something like that. But we need to be powerful, influential, simply to prevent others from troubling us. So powerful countries usually have strong economies. It's through the economy, directly or indirectly, that you influence other countries. Economy in turn means the ability to generate money. And this depends on the technology that that country is able to generate. Now, you may say, why is technology important? I'll come back to something we all know very well from our school education, the Battle of Plassey, which we lost. You know, Siraj ud-Daula was with the French, and the traitor Mir Jafar went over to the British, and people always say that we lost the Battle of Plassey because of Mir Jafar. Yes, but that was the time of intense rivalry between two technological powers, France and England. They were just using the battlegrounds in India, both in the Carnatic and in the Bengal and elsewhere, to fight their disputes. So we have the Indians and the French on one side, and then Mir Jafar and the British on the other side. In the end, the British side lost only 22 people in the entire battle. Our side lost about 600. Now, this happened apparently because the guns used by the English were more accurate than the guns used by Siraj ud-Daula and the French. So because of a failure of technology, we went into slavery for 200 years. It's plain and simple. So everything can be lost if you lack the correct technology at the correct time. Technology in turn needs science. You need a science base. And because out of science can come technology. You need your own science to develop your own technology. You know, as part of trying to protect ourselves, we've been buying guns and planes and weapons from other countries. Well, that's the only thing we can do, because we are not able to make these things ourselves. Many defense analysts have now said that India should have started making weapons right from the beginning. But to make a good gun, you need to know how to make very good steel. So somewhere it starts from science. You cannot just innovate out of nothingness. So you need a very strong science base. Now, science too, it just doesn't grow on trees. It doesn't come like that. People have to be taught how to do science. People first have to know what is science. And so then it comes to the question of education. So you see, from power, you go to economy, then you go to technology, then you go to science, and then you go to education. So one thing leads to the other. This is a typical scientist analysis. Anybody who feels that this is obvious already knows about science. And you are already sympathetic to science, if you could understand what I've been saying for the last 2-3 minutes. So what this then means is, think about it: power, economy, technology, science, education. Therefore, science education is strategic. It's a strategic item for a country. It's not just defense, finance, external affairs, and home. Education is strategic. All types of education, but science education is particularly strategic in the present context. The second point I want to make, which I've already mentioned briefly, is that science is strong in rich countries. Now let's forget about very, very long ago when India was a rich country and Indian science was strong. I am talking about basically the Vedic period and all that. But modern science as we know it, and the whole world subscribes to modern science or the modern way of doing science, started with the Renaissance and started in Italy, which in the 17th century was a very wealthy country. Holland too was another home of advanced science then. Gradually in the 18th century, France and England became the rich countries, and science was at its highest peak in those countries at that time. The Battle of Plassey, for instance, happened in the 18th century. And gradually the focus moved. England still continued to be strong, but then the powerhouse of 19th century science was obviously Germany. They were so far ahead of practically all the countries. So Germany was very rich, it was very powerful, the science was very good. Then we move to the 20th century, when the emphasis shifted to Russia and then finally America. And they have dominated science in the 20th century. The American domination of science continues in the 21st century. And you can see America actually is, you know, just an offshoot of Europe. They had the same European thought pool that the European countries had. And with that, they took the advantage of their new environment and became a scientific powerhouse. An interesting example of a very young country, very small country, which became very good in science in a short period of time is Israel. Now you may want to know why Israel became very good in science. It's because again the thought stream, the people pool, everything was European. It was like a little bit of Europe was put in the Middle East. So it is no wonder that that country became very good in science, because they also had other advantages of innovation and all that. But it is Israeli science is typically a kind of European science. So wherever that thought stream moved, science became strong. Japan and China are more interesting because the thought streams have come from an entirely different source. And it remains to be seen whether they become the powerful countries in science in the 21st century. So the connection I'm making here is science and wealth. You cannot do science in a poor country. And you cannot have a good science education system in a poor country. So we have here a vicious circle. We are poor and therefore we don't have a good science education system. We don't have a science education system because we are poor. So somewhere India has to break in through this vicious circle. Let us see what happened to us since 1947. Because 1947 is a watershed. We were a civilizational nation for 4,000 years. But we only had a political identity in 1947. And even that was a fractured identity. We were a broken country. We had just lost 1/3 of our land area and 1/4 of our population. And the partition deeply affected young India. I think it still affects us 70 years later. The shadow of partition has not gone away from this country, no matter what we may think. So we had so many problems in 1947. Firstly, we are very poor, no money. Then we have a national security problem because of partition. Then we have a religion problem because of partition. Then we have a health problem. The average lifespan of an Indian in 1947, an Indian male, was 27 years. For the average woman, it was even less. And plus, we had to bring about some terrific social changes because it was a deeply divided country in the matter of caste. So with all these huge problems, then where is the priority for education? I mean, we didn't even have the luxury to think long term. We have to deal with so many pressing problems. So rightly or wrongly, you know, a lesser priority was given to education in the earlier years. Now the question is to ask ourselves after 70 years, What have we done with ourselves? Have we attended to economy, national security, religion, health, social changes enough so that we can start looking at education and making it a priority item? And I'm sure you can think for yourself, economy, national security, religion, health, social changes. In all these, our record has only been mixed. Not a very happy state of affairs in any of these five areas. So, but still, this doesn't mean we cannot go on neglecting education forever. That is India in 47. What is India in 2020? Let's look at the present state of education, more specifically science education in India. Now, science can be taught to anybody from the age of 3 to the age of 100. Science is also very easy to teach. It's not difficult. It's not difficult to learn also. HRD ministry should know this. It's an easy subject. It's a fun subject. We should remove the fear of science in young people. I'll give you a small example. 3 years, I told you, no? You take a 3-year-old kid to a nice sunny playground and you put a cricket stump and then put it in the ground. And then take the kid there at 10 o'clock in the morning. There'll be a shadow on him. Then he'll see the shadow or she will see the shadow. Then you take him or her inside the house. At about 3 o'clock, you come again and show the shadow. It will be in a different place. A 3-year-old kid will think that that is magic. And that's very important because there is a magical quality of science which we seem to have lost in our present gobbledygook syllabuses that we have at various stages. If you take 4-year-old kid to that same playground and that cricket stump, the 4-year-old will figure out that at 10 o'clock in the morning it was in one position, 3 o'clock it's in another position, and tomorrow also if he or she comes at 10 o'clock it will be in the same position and 3 it will be in a different position. Now take the child again. The child is about 5 or 6. And start showing him or her the position of the shadow between 10 and 3. So vaguely the idea will come that this cricket stump can be used to measure time in a vague kind of way. Because at the age of 5 or 6, a child still doesn't have a clear idea of time. Give it a few years. Take a 10-year-old child there. Then you can start doing something more sophisticated. If you incline the stump to the ground at an angle of the latitude of the place, then the time is told quite accurately. What I'm describing is, of course, a sundial, which has been known to mankind right from the beginning. When the child is 12 or 13, you take him or her to Jandar Mandar in Jaipur or Delhi or the small one in Banaras, a 12 or 13-year-old child will be able to understand everything fully at that time. So, you see, over 10 years, you've given the idea a child of time. It is very important because as Indians, we lack a sense of time. I was very happy today that this program started exactly on time. And those who know me know that I am very, very particular about time. Because once you don't have an idea of time, you've lost everything. And COVID is teaching us that. It's telling us, it's come with a gun to our neck and says that unless you solve your problems very quickly, I'm going to finish you off. So people are cultures that lack a sense of time. You know, Salman Rushdie said that any country where the language, the word for yesterday is the same as the word for tomorrow has no sense of time. We may not like Rushdie for many things, but this is something he actually said. We have to, over 10 years, you know, you can teach a child the idea of time. And so you see, teaching science is a long-term exercise. You cannot learn it in 1 year, cram all the books, get 100 marks in CBSE, then get the joint entrance exam IIT all in 2 years and then go to sleep for the rest of your life. It doesn't work like that. The science education has to be put in slowly, systematically, and with a lot of patience. The kind of patience that bureaucrats and politicians may not be able to show. But certainly those in the education business have to show. Teacher cannot be impatient with the student. So you see, this is, I looked at some of the syllabuses of 10th standard and plus 2 science syllabuses. I had an observation which I want to share with you. At both the 10th and plus 2, there is too little experiment and too much theory. This is very bad because science is experiment. Science is about seeing, hearing, smelling, touching, feeling. It's about the physical senses. That is why it is called physical sciences. Scientists are worried about real things. We leave all more esoteric things to humanities people and social science people. That is their job. Let them do it. But we are worried about physical things. We are not emphasizing experiment enough. Okay, a 10th standard kid is what, for 15, 16 years? He or she can do more experiments than what is there in that syllabus. The theory can be brought down. Again, I'll give you a small example. Dr. Joshi says that there are many stories about me. I don't know about that, but I like to tell stories. You go to the lab. You know, you look at, say, the student is shown two samples. One is copper nitrate and one is copper sulfate. The textbooks will tell you that both are light blue in color. But if you are shown these crystals of these two, 9 people out of 10 will realize, yes, they are light blue in color, but copper sulfate is more like peacock blue. And copper nitrate has got just a trace of green in it. And also the crystals of copper nitrate look darker than the crystals of copper sulfate. Now, I cannot describe this in words, but if you see the two samples, copper nitrate, copper sulfate, 9 students out of 10 will know that. There are other textbook things that you can do. You can dissolve it in water. You will get light blue solution of the same color. Then you can add barium chloride solution to that, which is easily available. Copper sulfate will give a white precipitate. Copper nitrate will give nothing. So then you can definitely be sure. But from sight itself, you can make out your taste. The fellow who discovered saccharin discovered it by accident in 1870 or 1880. He was in the lab doing so many things. And by mistake, you know, he put his mouth near his hand and he did like that. And he like that. And then suddenly he found a sweet taste. Very sweet. He didn't know what was going on and he knew he had found something by accident, something new, which was extremely sweet, and there was nothing in the experiment he was doing that resembled any sugar-like compound. So he did something which I will not recommend to anybody. Please don't say that this professor of chemistry is recommending this. It's not recommended at all what he did. But he started tasting all the chemicals on his lab bench to see which of them was sweet. Luckily for the world, the other chemicals which were not sweet were also harmless. Then he found the compound which was very, very sweet, and that was saccharin. So you see, when I said seeing, smelling, hearing, touching, feeling, science is about all these things. If you put more experiment and less theory in 10 and plus 2, far lesser students will run away from science and join social sciences and humanities, because anybody can learn science, can enjoy science and do science. And you don't need to get a science degree and then do PhD and all. I'll come to PhD in a minute. Just to have a scientific bent of mind is enough. If you know why monsoons come in June, if you know why two brothers or two sisters or a brother and a sister look alike, but sometimes they don't look alike also. You know, if you know answers to questions like this, That means you have enough science appreciation. You don't need to be a science PhD in genetics to know why two brothers resemble each other. And why sometimes they resemble, sometimes they may not resemble. Why a child will resemble sometimes only one parent, but sometimes they resemble both. All these things are, you know, things that one should pick up out of curiosity. And this is the other thing. Our whole educational system, our whole way of life, we curb this curiosity. We don't encourage curiosity. We say, shh, don't ask all these things. Not good for you. It won't help you to get into IIT joint entrance exam. See, you cannot talk like that. Teachers, parents, they're all talking in the same fashion. Let him ask or let her ask all sorts of crazy questions. Let the child draw a picture of a chapati and color it blue. It's fun, you know, it's okay. You can draw it green also, red the other next third day. It doesn't matter. The thing is, the curiosity should not be killed. Because there are two things which are needed in science. One of them is curiosity. I'll come to the second one later. But remember, C for curiosity. If you're not curious, you even over curious is okay, but under curious is not okay in science education. A child should be interested. When you show copper nitrate and copper sulfate, then the child should be curious enough to know what is the color of copper chloride or copper carbonate. You know, even though it may not come in the exam. That's the kind of curiosity which you must try to encourage. Now, the trouble actually in India really begins at BSc. Because this is where the system has collapsed. It gets only worse at the MSc stage. And in a few minutes I'll come to why there is a problem in the BSc and MSc level. In my view, I have a simple test for a good BSc program or a good BA program for that matter. If you do a good BA or BSc program in any subject, you should get to the point when once you go into daily life, nobody should be able to cheat you easily. For me, that is the test. If you figure out that somebody is cheating you, then you may have that knowledge from your common sense or genetics. But anybody who has done a good BA or BSc, good one, he or she will not get cheated. Similarly, I'll say that anyone who has done a good MA or MSc course in any subject should come to the point where you become broad-minded, inclusive, moderate, objective, and not so opinionated. Today, if you see young people, especially on social media and all that, where I follow some of them, they are none of these things. They are not broad-minded, they are not inclusive, they are not moderate, they are not objective, and they are extremely opinionated, and they know practically nothing. You see, the last thing, it comes because they have not been educated properly. BA, BSc, MA, MSc, doesn't matter. So you see, the education must be holistic, it must be very broad-based. Science gives you that slight push towards quantitative physical things. In fact, the way the syllabus is structured after 10th, you have to choose between science stream or humanities, social science stream. You should not have to do that. Even after plus two, you should have an option of a person who does science subjects in plus two should be able to go for BA, provided he or she is able to pass some qualifying exam for BA. There may be people who are interested in many things. For example, I know some of my friends know that when I was in those years, I was interested in both chemistry and history. People are quite interesting. Everybody knows two people are the same. So by regimenting them into science and humanities by the plus two stage itself is not good. The new national education policy says that science students should have some course in social science or humanities, and some of the IITs are doing that. I'll also say the reverse. All humanities degrees must have a basic science course. Some of these products of our various progressive universities will not be shouting so much today if they had some simple courses on sundials and monsoons and Mendel's heredity and all that. Simple stuff, no complicated. But just to tell what is the scientific way of doing things, that's enough. And that is what our educational policies must reflect. It cannot be this regimental thing. Then we move on to PhD. Now here I will say something controversial. The PhD is an elitist program. It must be. A PhD is not a right. It is a privilege. Just because you have finished an MSc and got first class, because you have nothing else to do, you cannot start PhD. We have grossly overproduced our PhDs because we overestimated the demand, and we started producing a lot of these guys, PhDs, around the year 2000. So what has happened is, the number of PhDs started increasing. Now we don't know what to do with them. Because the traditional way of getting rid of our PhDs has vanished. And what was the traditional way? Exporting them to America. So that route has really cut down. This morning I have seen that President Trump is going to stop all these H-1B visas and all that. So USA is also closing down. In COVID, all countries are closing down. They're looking into themselves. So that route has gone. And so what are we going to do with all these PhDs? All want government jobs. Impossible. Can't get. So you must make the PhD program more elitist. It's some kind of a vague thing where people who are underqualified get into this simply because they got some fellowship from government which will pay them. So all this is, you know, part of the problem. Now, this is really the state between school, 10 plus 2, BSc, MSc, PhD. Standard of some of these places is good. The central universities, some of them at least, the science departments are good. They are standards for the state universities to aspire towards. Whether the central universities are good because they are good or because they are getting more money than the state universities has to be now looked into seriously. So this brings me to the next point. As to, you know, why we have problems. And I plan to spend some major time on this. I think you've generally got the drift of what I've been saying. Many of our problems have arisen because of our poor economy. We are simply too big. There are too many people in this country. And the wealth generating potential is not never been sufficient to keep up with the ever increasing population. And, you know, we have tried what other countries have tried in our position. I mean, I'm not saying that we must always look at our good points. Science can be developed and strengthened using both what is called the top-down approach and the bottom-up approach. In 1947, we really went for the top-down approach, that is starting a few elite institutions. Atomic energy, CSIR, couple of places where all the science is done. And gradually it is hoped that this effect of these good places will trickle down. IITs started a little later. IITs are now 60 years old. So you have a few things in the top because we don't have money to have so many. So we started with a few and then hope that this effect trickles down. Gradually, because of these issues of social changes and all that, we started this bottom up. Bottom up doesn't start with BSc It starts at the school. The primary education is vital. Unless the primary education is good, higher education, it cannot be good. So we tried, we are starting, but neither top down nor bottom up is enough. Again, I'll give you an analogy. I am sure many of you have done a nice jigsaw puzzle. And if you don't know what this is a picture which is made up of several small pieces which you have to join together. You have jigsaw puzzles with 500 pieces, 1000 pieces. So sometimes whole families will sit around this puzzle and in a few hours we'll complete the whole picture. Now, we all know, those of us who have done these jigsaw puzzles will know that suppose you have a 1000 piece puzzle and for some reason 50 of the 1000 pieces are lost or they are taken away from you at random, 50 have gone. So you only got 950 pieces. All of you will understand that with 950 pieces out of 1000, you can finish off more or less the whole picture. There will be a few gaps in the end, but more or less you would get the whole picture and you will get an idea what is happening. Now imagine the other situation. Out of the 1000 pieces, 950 have been taken away from you and you are only given 50 pieces and you are told make the whole picture. You will all tell me it is impossible. And yes, it is impossible. That is what has happened with our science enterprise in this country. We don't have money either for the top or for the bottom. We have no money. And after COVID, we have even less money. So the first thing is that poor economy. Second point. Separating teaching and research. This is something very bad that we have done. Because of some old historical accidents, which I don't really want to go into, research got pushed into certain elite research institutions in the 1950s. And all universities were supposed to largely do teaching. Now, to some extent in social sciences and humanities, but certainly to a very large extent in sciences, any teaching institution must have a small component or larger component of research. I already told you about experiments. You know, the person, the fellow, he will never forget copper nitrate and copper sulfate. But the same thing after a few years, if you tell him what are the three ways of extracting nickel from its ores, he will not remember at all. But copper nitrate, copper sulfate, even if he goes into something else like management or business, he will not forget those colors. So you see, without proper base, and that's what I mean by research. Research is, you know, going to the lab and doing experiments and stuff like that. So any teaching institution must have this research component. In BSc, it can be very small, maybe 5%, 10%. By MSc, it can be 15-20%. Don't need more than that. By the time you come to a PhD granting institution, of course, the research becomes 100%. But by separating the teaching and research completely at the state university level, we have really killed everything. We have thrown the baby out with the bathwater in this. Because you cannot have just purely teaching institutions unless they are of very modest scope. There is still room and place for purely teaching institutions, but even there, the BSc student should at least be taken on a visit to a plant or a factory or taken to a lab where somebody is doing PhD. This was done with us when I was in college, in Xavier's College in Bombay. They were also doing MSc in those days and PhD. So they had a small research lab, but BSc students were regularly taken to small chemical companies around Bombay. Of course, I was very lucky to grow up in Bombay because many of these companies and all are there, so we could easily go and see. So there has to be some knowledge in these places that there is something called research, because it is only research that leads to technology. Don't forget what I said in the very beginning. Research culture, science base will then lead to technology. So this separation of teaching and research is something very bad. And further, we have actually added insult to injury that in some of these research institutions, we have started bringing in teaching. So not only have we taken out research from the teaching places, we have put in teaching into purely research places. I have said time and time and time again that CSIR scientists are not professors. Their business is not to train PhD students. And towards the end, I'm coming to kinds of things we can do. I think the government departments, the government labs, they should be purely put into strategic work, which can be 100% research. No problems. Let them solve vital problems of national importance, COVID, all these things. Please don't put the responsibility and burden on a professor or an associate professor or an assistant professor dealing with 50, 100, 200, 500 students. Don't ask him or her to start doing something that will help us to solve COVID problem tomorrow. Please don't do that. Because this is not the job of even research professors. Their job is to teach. Their job is to turn out very good scientists, whether at the BSc, MSc or PhD level. And after having done that, their job is done. You know, so the separation of teaching and research is something that it has really caused a big problem. Then this leads to, therefore, poor economy and separation leads to a total collapse of the state universities. Prime Minister has spoken about this, I think, in the Ludhiana Science Congress. He has called for a strengthening of the state university system. But nothing seems to have been done on the ground. And when you don't have money and you have too many people to cater to, then the mind will go in other ways. There are four problems as I see in these state universities. I call them VPCC, VPCC. V for violence, P for politics, C for caste, C for corruption. VPCC, violence, politics, caste, corruption. All these four problems arise because of no money. You know, so it doesn't matter. Each of these, I can give a 1 hour lecture. So all of us know what these problems are. I'm not going to get into it. But there has to be some way in which we can, if we do not save our state universities, I think all is gone. So economy, separation of teaching and research, collapse of state universities. And finally, the matter of reservations. There is no point in saying that we don't have this problem because we have this problem. And once again, I will make it clear that where my stand is that reservations for SC, STs is a social and cultural compulsion, because those reservations are very different from other kinds of reservations. The problems of the SC, STs communities go far above the issues of education alone. Because as we all know, those communities were kept outside Chaturvarna. And this is why it has been enshrined in our constitution right from the beginning. So this is an entirely different matter which we should not tinker with, you know, whatever be the emotion. The other reservations, basically mandal and post-mandal, I think all need to be looked at. Because, you know, we can see what is happening now. The other day, Madras High Court has said that it's not a fundamental right for an OBC to claim reservation in a medical college. It will probably go to Supreme Court or whatever. So these are matters which I believe should be taken up, because once again, and as I have said earlier and elsewhere, having reservations costs us money. Costs us real money, and we don't have money after COVID. Now, I think I have about 10 minutes or so, 10 to 12 minutes or so, because I was asked to speak for 1 hour. I'll try to outline some possible solutions. India is full of people who describe problems. They're very good at that. They're very good at, you know, self-criticism. Not so many people try to provide solutions. And not so many people try to see the good points of Indian culture and society through which alone we can solve our problems. We must use our strong points to solve these problems, because as I told you, we have got so many huge problems. And what do we want? What do I want? In 50 years, I would like to see an India where we are way ahead of China and we are able to look at America like an equal partner. That's the kind of India I want. I am not at all satisfied with saying that India is the leader of the South. You know, all the South countries will look upon India as their Vishwa Guru and all that. I am not in favor of that, because India is a very great country. It was the greatest country in the world in the past. So what has been that great can certainly has the potential of being that great, because the essential thing that was there in India 2,000, 3,000, 4,000 years ago is still very much there in India today. It's not something, see this, Ahmed Zaveri, the famous Egyptian Nobel laureate, said that there are three ancient cultures that he admired: ancient Egypt, ancient China, and ancient India. He says among these three ancient civilizations, he admires India the most, because only in India the old culture is still not just there, but it is very strong. Whereas he says ancient Egypt and ancient China have lost it somewhere along the way. You see, outsiders are telling. It is not something that I am telling you guys. And so I come to solutions. Firstly, you know, I hope this much at least is clear, that the money will never be enough. COVID has dealt us a terrific blow. It has dealt the whole world a terrific blow. Yesterday I was seeing in the television that the United Kingdom has seen the steepest fall in the monthly profitability of its companies, 10% loss in just one month. It never happened before. So all countries have suffered. We are also suffering. So there is simply no money. Already we had no money. Now you have even less money. So what needs to be done? First thing I would recommend is that the limited money we have should be put more into primary education. Now today, you know, if you look at the budgets, the budget of the HRD ministry is about 1 lakh crores per year. So this is before COVID came, and the amounts have been slashed after COVID. But let us stick to what was presented in the budget in February. So 1 lakh crores, that means 100,000 crores is the budget of HRT, of which 60,000 crores went into primary education and 40,000 crores went into higher education. 60 primary, 40 higher. Now in this higher education, 40,000 crores, IITs got 8,000 crores. The NITs got 3,000 crores. The Central University got 8,000 crores. And AICTE UGC got 5,000 crores. So IIT 8, NIT 3, Central University 8. AICTE UGC means all the state universities and all the small places which these two bodies are funding. Now there are, for the latest count, something like 23 IITs, around 50 central universities and 31 NITs. So this means roughly each NIT gets 100 crores per year. Each IIT gets 320 crores per year. And each central university gets 160 crores per year. The question I ask is this money we are giving to these institutions worth it for the taxpayer? What can we expect back from these places? So many arguments people have said. In the bad days of the 70s and 80s, IITs were losing 70% of their BTECs to America. Now I am told it is something more like 20 to 25%, but still 20 to 25 loss to America is still quite a lot, if you ask me. And what are these IIT people doing after they graduate BTECs? Some management or some this, some that. How many are actually into entrepreneurship like Dr. Joshi, who is not an IIT BTEC? He runs a very successful set of companies making scientific instrument. But surely the IIT BTEC should be an employment generator. The kind of money that is being spent on him or her, similarly for the central universities, 160 crores per central university is not a joke in a poor country. So this outlay 40,000. So if you take IIT, NIT, Central University, AICT, UGC, you get about 23 crores and some extras are also there in the rest. So about 30,000 crores or 40,000 crores are going to these elite places. The top-down model. So the bottom-up model, you know, 60,000 crores for all the schools and small places all over the country. Now I'm just going to tell you a small story again. When I say, is this money worth it? There's a piece of equipment at the high-end science called cryo-electron microscope, called cryo-EM. Now each of these instruments costs about 100 crores. So I think there is one or two places in India planning to get or something, or install something like that. So a very small number, they have got this 100 crore equipment. Now instead, I hope somebody in HRD is also thinking, suppose I take these 100 crores and put it in schools in villages, that is 1 crore per village. And I spread this 1 crore out over, say, 10 years. So 100 crores, 100 schools, 1 crore over 10 years, 10 lakhs per school, only to put labs for class 8, 9 and 10, no plus 2. So 8, 9 and 10, you can teach them about sundials and copper nitrate and, you know, heredity and all, have fun time in the lab. So 10 lakhs in a per year per school. Now which 100 crores is more usefully spent? Now I know what they'll say in HRD. They'll say, no, we are doing both. Don't worry, we can buy the cryo EM and we can also put it in these 100 schools. And they'll show some facts and figures also. Bureaucrats are very good at producing all those numbers. But then what I'll tell them is, that's all okay, you could do it. Now after COVID, you cannot do it. Because of COVID, instead of that 100 crores, you have got only 50 crores. So I cannot buy half a cryo EM for 50 crores because it doesn't work like that. I cannot buy half the equipment and get half the results. I can put 50 crores in the 50 schools only. That I can do. But then you can say that, what is the use? It will not get used properly. The other day I saw a very strange but very sad incident. I hope it is not true, but looks like it was true. That there was some teacher in UP who had 25 jobs simultaneously. And so she was getting 25 salaries and she had amassed a sum of 1 crore or so. So such a thing can only happen if they are not taking attendance in any of the schools, or at least in 24 of these 25 schools they are not taking attendance. Let us say that she gave attendance in one place, I hope at least that she did. So if you give them the 100 crores to these universities, she will go and take up 100 jobs and she will swallow up all the 100 crores. So that's a problem. Now at the same, so this is hardcore corruption. Now if you go to the cryo EM, then there will be soft core activities which are not so obvious. You got that cryo EM in that lab. There will be people there maybe who don't know how to use that equipment properly, so they may not be able to use it to its full capacity. Such a machine cannot be switched off also. So suddenly if there's a power cut, like in Bangalore all the time in the monsoon, big trees are falling on electrical wires and we get long power cuts. They'll say, no, we have got a power backup, we got second backup. All that will go. So suddenly the machine which is never supposed to be switched off gets switched off. So then you have to call a maintenance person. He will not come because he has to come from UK. So basically the machine itself, downtime is very high for expensive equipment. And we don't have the infrastructure wherewithal to sustain. Even if it works, you would hire somebody who studied in one of these top labs of cryo EM in UK or someplace. So he or she will be given a job. So he or she will come, they will use this cryo EM, they will write a few papers. But those papers may be collaborating with that foreign chap who is the expert. So then the name will appear as one of 25 authors in a paper of Science and Nature. And then we will all go and do tali bajao and say, see, this proves the greatness of Indian science. So now you tell me whether the teacher gobbling up 100 crores by taking up 100 jobs is worse for us, or this kind of silent loss of the money simply because we really don't know what to do and we end up doing something that has no impact. So both the things have no impact. I hope that there are people in HRD who feel that both this primary school and the cryo EM in the sophisticated lab are both a big waste of money. So let us take these 100 crores and give it to some place like Ministry of Textiles or Ministry of Surface Transportation or Ministry of Railways, where something worthwhile seems to be going on. Maybe they will use this 100 crores better than what we can use it. Because it's clear that without, you see, a lot of things are the new normal, they say. All funny words have started coming after COVID. So what is the new normal? You have to prioritize. And if you ask me, if I was given this 100 crore matter, I would say that you should take the 100 crores completely and put it in the village school. Because neglecting to write some paper or writing some substandard paper is difficult to catch and there's no accountability. But today we have some tradition starting of rooting out corruption. Corruption is the easiest thing to root out in our present dirty scenario. And the village schools, if you eliminate corruption, then that money, 100 crores, will be used properly in the village. So I feel that in many of these cases, money should go be transferred from higher education to primary education. I think that is the first of the what I would call reforms. If you remove corruption, which I believe is easy, remember I said VPCC, violence, politics, caste, corruption. If you remove corruption, the other three will also go. Violence will go, politics will go, and caste will also go. Because you have caste-based reservations. But that's not the answer, you know. Then it becomes OBC versus MBC, Yadav versus Jat versus Thakur, you know, and all this will then lead to more corruption only, nothing else. So if you remove corruption, and the present government now seems to have a hold on this, so they are at least able to identify and start addressing the issues of corruption. I think it is not only the easiest thing to remove, but I think violence, politics, and caste will also go. About reservations, I have said enough. We need to look and we need to start a discussion on all the mandal reservations. The others, SCST, has to remain because that problem is not really the problem of the HRD ministry. It is something the whole country has inherited, our whole civilization has inherited that problem. So it is very big. But the OBC and MBC reservations are all political things. And all political things also have political answers. So I think that is the way we should look at that. And I finally said that I'll talk about the future, the distant future. As I said, the civilizational aspect. Somewhere we have to start thinking about our remote past. People talk about making entire science in India as Vedic science or Indic science. This is not so easy. 500, 600 years we have lived with European science and it looks like that is the way it will continue. What we need to do, however, is to start bringing back a study of the old subjects. And so that's what I call soft power of Indian science, as opposed to the hard power of getting money. How do you get money? As I said, always there is no money. What are these IITs and central universities going to do? If you take away the money from them, they have to start becoming partially or fully self-financing. The IITs have gone on for 60 years. Most educational experiments in most countries which lasted 60 years started showing signs of big success. So these places, these top end places, must be told that within 2 years, 3 years, we are going to become completely self-financing. You can go to private sector, you can do anything you want. And if you are doing something that's good enough, the private sector will come to you. Today I know that Dr. Joshi, in his own small way, is supporting fellowships in many universities, small universities. Industry will come to you. You don't have to go near anybody. If they know that you have something to offer them, industry will not just pour money into a rat hole. And if you just say something, I'll do this, I'll do that, I'll write a couple of papers, then industry is not interested in that. So this whole business of self-financing, if you ask me, IIT is 100%. NIT is 50%. Central universities, at least the research component in the science departments, must become self-financing. It should stop going to all this UGC, HRD, DST, DBT, all that can stop because it's been going on for too long and the results are not commensurate with all these other huge problems which I have indicated. And finally, the last 1 minute, the present and COVID. You know, I have just quote very briefly from an excellent article in Indian Express that came just this morning from Milind Soni, who is in IIT Bombay and presently on deputation to IIT Goa. He calls for what he calls decentralization of science. That's basically what I've been arguing. When I say push it back into the primary education, push it back to the state universities. Few, you know, 5, 10, 20, 50 top elite central institutions. He says that COVID can only be solved today because we don't have the safety of lockdown anymore. We have to enter the real world. And he says this problem can only now be solved at village level, town level, district level. It cannot even be solved at a state level. And he says that if you don't decentralize and you don't ask these elite, and he also says in his article, elite scientists from elite places have not bothered to find out what are the local problems of the village, the town, the small community. And he says, unless you know those local issues, you are not going to be able to solve. And he says a nice quotation, which I will also going to finish off with this. He says, if you do not decentralize, without this, the post-corona Indian society would be an unhappy attempt at making the old arrangement work in a degraded reality of fearful and angry people. These are powerful words. Without decentralization of science, the post-corona Indian society would be an unhappy attempt that making the old arrangement work in a degraded reality of fearful and angry people. So the responsibilities of the HRD ministry today, if you ask me, are simply huge. And I will end as I began. There is a crying need to include education. Incidentally, that's one of the recommendations of the National Education Policy that I thoroughly approve, and that is to change the name of the Ministry of HRD back to its old name, Ministry of Education. Because human beings are just not resources to be processed. You know, human resource development. It's a very patronizing description. What was wrong with the old name, Ministry of Education? Call it Vidya Mantralaya or Shiksha Mantralaya, something like that. If you want to go for an Indian, like you have Ministry of Ayush, why don't you have like this, Ministry of Vidya or Ministry of Shiksha? I think I hope that this huge burden, and I think along with, again, as I said, finance, home, external affairs and defense, this education should be put on the list of crucial, vital ministries. Because our strategic interest and our very safety and security depends on a totally new and different approach to science education in our beloved country. Thank you all very much. Jai Hind.
Thank you, sir.
So,
thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir.
I hope it could be heard properly, you know.
Yes, sir. So, Dr. Ashish, so.
Yes, sir.
Just put okay. Me on.
Yeah, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Am I audible?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Mr. Sujit, can you put me on live? Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. And really, it won't be wrong if I say that you are a legend, you are a living legend in the field of science. And absolutely, it's a lifetime, a cherished opportunity, which cannot be forgotten by anyone of us.
and I thank you very much. Sir, actually we have received a lot of queries, but I assume that most of the queries you have already covered in your address. But it's my own personal query, and as well as the queries from the attendees. This is the one question, the very simple question. Can you explain how to improve upon a lab activity in a science education among the students and stakeholders during this pandemic situation where the social distancing is mandatory?
In the pandemic, not much is possible. You know, because of social distancing, because still people are scared to come and do the things. I think it's going to be very difficult, and we are going to have to work extra hard when the lockdown is more relaxed. Because right now, you know, human health, human risk. Today, our institute, for example, has strict rules. And only the other day, they said people above 65 and between 65 and 70 can get a permission to come in. And I understand even many people who are younger than that, faculty members, have not yet dared to venture into the IISc. It's nothing, no fault of IISc, but people are scared of the disease, you know. So it's going to take some time, and that's where we are really looking for the leadership to tell us at the central, state, and as what Professor Sohoni says, how they can empower local communities, take the initiative and try to start. It's going to be very, very difficult. I hope people who have been listening to the webinar will realize how very difficult our situation is today. It is not easy, and it's not something that we can just go back to the old thing and say everything is fine. Everything is not fine. So I don't know if I've provided the answer that you wanted, but lab work is going to be extremely difficult now. You can do some things like lab simulations on the computer, and I have seen some of those also. I have participated in some myself, but I tell you, it's not the real thing. No.
Okay. Thank you, sir. And if I can recapitulate one quote from the Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan, that time I was in a 12th standard, and he quote in the essay, in his essay that is related to women's education in India. And he quote, I just quote the same lines, and I can conclude your whole address in that frame. The chief purpose of our education is not merely acquiring a bookish knowledge, but we have to learn those more skills which is beyond our space and time. So I can conclude all these, your address, within these quotes, and it's an honor also, and I'm very thankful to you, sir.
Now, Rashid, can you make me a line? Just I want to say two lines that I leave
out there. Sure, sir. Please. Make me line. Dr. Joseph, please.
Yes, can you make me line? Yes. Thank you very much, sir. And I always believe in practical approach. And today, I would like to say two lines, you know, out of what I conceived. It's not necessary. Kids only grow healthy and brilliant if the parents are PhD in genetics. Second point is very strong. Either understand the taste, or let's not talk about the taste. Thank you very much once again, sir, for letting the whole society. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your insight word. You're always an inspiration for young generation of this country. Now I would like to request Dr. Arun Kumar, director of the institute. Please, sir, please come on a stage and please vote of thanks.
Thank you, Ashish. I think, Professor Desaraju, it has been a real privilege to listen to your views on the overall scenario of education in our country. Sir, I would confess, when they have arranged this seminar, or rather webinar, now what we call it a webinar, I was expecting that, you see, it would be on online platforms, you know, and digital teaching, etc., etc. This is what is happening today. We are having by dozens, you know, these kind of webinars where people are talking of that, how to use digital platform for teaching after post-pandemic scenario. And this is what was my theme of You see, when I welcomed you, that was the theme I was expecting to you. It came as such a pleasant surprise to me to have your views, you see, on what ails education in our country. And I think it is an eye-opening talk for most of us, rather for all of us. It's a democracy. Many of us agree with you, many of us may not agree with you, but that doesn't change the situation. We have to start from the rural scenario. As I just, you see, when I was collecting the statistical data of the using of the internet facilities, I was shocked when I got the data that only 12% of the households in rural India had the facility of internet for education. So it was really shocking for me. I didn't know it earlier. Only today morning I thought, let me see, I have collected it from other countries. Let me see what is the situation in my own country. I found that we are even worse than Indonesia, for that matter. So obviously, I think we'll all agree. I'm also a scientist come educationist. I came into education after completing my tenure, a full tenure with Government of India as a scientist. And sir, I realized that we not need to be that about education. And I think even if the government doesn't take so much part, so long we have enlightened educationists like you in our country, I think education is in safe hands. It is definitely going to progress further, sir. And with this, sir, on behalf of our institute and behalf of all the participants and Dr. Joshi, we extend our heartfelt thanks to you for having accepted our invitation to deliver this very enlightening talk. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you, sir. God bless.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your kind words. And again, I would like. Suji, sir, can you put me on live?
Sir, camera on kijiye.
Can you put me on live? Ah, yes. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for your kind words. And above all, I thank all the attendees from across the colleges, universities, research institutions, as your participation to this program has turned out to be a success event. And I would like to thank, on behalf of Professor Desraju, on behalf of all organizing team, to Mr. Sujit, our technical expert, for this valuable support during the entire program. Thank you. Thank you, Sujit. And thank you all attendees who attend this program. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Ashish, you can ask for a feedback from the participants.